Met a couple more people here.
I'll get them.
And we'll get going. Thank you so much, everybody, for jumping on today. This is our, wow, what a great, I went to gallery view. What a great look. This is the May meeting of the West Virginia Entrepreneurship Ecosystem. My name is Bill Woodrum. I'm the coordinator of the West Virginia Entrepreneurship Network and the new West Virginia Business Program.
Bill, let's pause and let's mute everyone.
Okay.
And then you'll have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, I can do that. All right. Thank you so much, Tina, for that timely reminder. And then a reminder to our presenters, as you go to present, you'll have to unmute yourselves. But thank you for coming on today. We have a few presentations today. We were a little light on the agenda until the last few minutes. We've added a couple things and we'll get going. It is my pleasure first to present Ariane Olish, who is the director of Startup West Virginia and is here to talk to us today about the iCORE program at WVU and part of the Spotlight program for the month.
Thank you, Bill, and there thanks for having me. I'll go ahead and share my screen now. Let's see, does that come across okay?
Yes.
Okay, great. So it's nice to see everyone on today. I apologize if I sound a little stuffy. I think some of you who are on here who know me, I'm getting over a horrible cold. So hopefully my voice will last through this, but I won't take too much time. But I would encourage you, if you have questions about this program, please feel free to reach out to me afterwards. I can drop my email in the chat. I can also send these slides. Bill, if it's okay, maybe I'll send the slides to you after today. And then if anybody wants a copy, please feel free to send those out as well. And also, we should have some time at the end for questions. This, like I said, this won't take too long. But I would like to talk to everybody today about the National Science Foundation iCORE program. And this is a program for the entire state of West Virginia that we're administering. So a little bit about the program. Let me see here. So it was created roughly in 2011, and this was an initiative of the National Science Foundation really to help move technology that they were investing in through grants and research opportunities into the commercial market. And so they realized that there was a fundamental gap for researchers who had really interesting, cool technology. There was a gap in helping those folks translate their research and their ideas really into a commercial market space. And so what they did is they started working with Steve Blank. I'm sure that name is familiar to a number of you on the call, but he has kind of this principle of this business model campus and this lean launch methodology, which really focuses on a hypothesis-driven approach to customer discovery and to building your business model. So the whole kind of principle of this, which I'll talk a little bit about, is come up with a hypothesis for why your product is actually solving a problem, and then get out there and talk to customers and figure out if your hypothesis is correct or if it's wrong. And if it's wrong, how do you need to pivot? And so the really nice thing about this is it's really focused on teaching customer discovery, especially for folks who are either new to the entrepreneurial space or maybe just haven't had a lot of experience in that realm. Oops, I went the wrong way there. So just to kind of give you a brief overview so you kind of understand the structure of it. So obviously the National Science Foundation is a federal level agency. This program has what's called hubs and then sites. So the hubs, which used to be referred to as nodes. So if anybody sees that kind of in the literature or anywhere online, we're moving from a node system to what are now hubs. So we are part of the Upper New York hub. So we partner with Cornell. So that's the primary hub. The state of West Virginia is a site through that hub. So the Upper New York node or hub is how you'll see it referred to on the website. And then West Virginia as a whole state is the site. So this is not something that's specific to WVU or to any university. And I'll talk about this a little bit more, but it's open to anybody. So whether or not you're attached to a university, if you're just a community member, the regional program is really open to anyone. So the goals of this program, the first is to conduct customer interviews. So you'll learn how to actually get out there, talk to potential customers, and really importantly, identify who the correct customers are to be talking to. What's interesting about this course, without getting too much into it, is that there's a really unique way that they approach customer discovery, which is you're not actually allowed to talk or pitch your product at all. So you purely have to go find customers and really drill down what are some key pain points for them. And then from that, you can kind of determine whether or not your product or your technology is solving a pain point and if there's a financial gain in that solution. What this then allows you to start building is really start building a validated business plan. So again, thinking about who your potential customers are. Through the course, you'll start working on the business model canvas and start filling out some of the buckets. So who are some of your key partners? What are your distribution channels going to look like? Some of those pieces. And then an important part here is to connect to mentors. So we have a wonderful group of teachers. I see some of them on the call here who teach the course for West Virginia. We want those teachers to really be a source of connection and support for anybody that comes through the course, as well as our teachers and colleagues up at Cornell. So as much as we can support and help you, again, this is a great entry point course for folks who want to get more involved, more engaged in the ecosystem, for us to help connect you into additional resources. So the West Virginia Regional Short Course, it's about 3.5 weeks right now. It's done completely virtually. And this is a very part-time course. So I want to make sure that everybody knows, you know, we have full-time professors, full-time clinicians who participate in this course. We have full-time graduate students and undergraduate students. So this is very much something you can do part-time. What you should expect is about 1 to 2 1 or 2 hour sessions per week. That's more of like the didactic sessions where an instructor is going to present and give you information. And then a lot of your time is going to be spent doing customer discovery. And that's very self-led. So that's at your own time, your own schedule. But you will have a couple check-ins with the instructors throughout the first couple of weeks. At the end, there's a wrap-up session. We kind of go through everything that you've learned. You're going to be able to re-pitch at the end. So the very first day, we ask you to pitch your technology. And you know, in a very nice way, it's called radical candor. I'm sure some of you are familiar with that. The teachers kind of break that down and break your pitch down and really help you focus again on what is the problem that you're solving and how is your technology doing that. And so the wrap-up session, you're going to apply all of the lessons learned to kind of pitching that technology again. So there's 2 levels to the NSFI Corp program. There's the regional course, which is what I just talked about. And then there's a national level. So to get to the national level, you either have to have previous NSF funding. So that might be a research grant, or you have to have gone through the regional course. The national program is a much more intensive version of the regional course. So it's 7 to 8 weeks long. There is a $50,000 grant that goes with that, but again, that's purely to kind of help support your time. A lot of that money, again, pre-COVID was allocated for travel. So we might see an adjustment in that grant funding going forward. But again, the 7 week course, what they want you to do is they want you to get over 100 customer interviews in that 7 weeks. So it's fairly time intensive. But for the national program, you do have to have a 3-member team. So at the regional level, we will let you do the regional course with just yourself if you want to do it. We do recommend it's always best to have at least 2 people per team just to kind of help divvy up the work and that sort of thing. But for the national course, you have to have an entrepreneurial lead, a technical lead, and then a business mentor. And that is required for the course. The other difference I will say about the national level program is that that is really focused on deep tech companies and ideas. So for the regional level, we again will let pretty much anybody enter. There is an application form that you have to go through, and then we will accept or deny application depending on what our enrollment looks like for that course. But we've had people who are coming up with new board games, to app developers, to people who are developing new energy solutions. For the national program, again, it really has to be a hard science focused technology and product to make it into that course. So there's a little bit more restrictions on that program. But this is a great program. If you look at the statistics for how this program has been successful over the years, they've at the national level have had just about 650 startup companies go through, and there's been quite a number of successful companies that have come out of that program. So some of the values at the regional level, again, you're going to learn some of the basics of entrepreneurship, how to start building your business plan, really understand, again, how to move your technology from kind of just this research and development stage into the market by really focusing on customers and where that value is. This is also a really fantastic program if you're considering SBIR or STTR funding. Success rate for those grants goes up dramatically when you have gone through the NSF I-Corps course. That's applicable even if you're going after NIH funding or DoD funding. Again, it really just gives you those valuable fundamentals of developing what the actual value is for your technology or your product. So to date in West Virginia, we've had now over 52 teams complete the course. Over five teams have gone on to the national program. From what we've been able to track, we've had two teams receive SBIR and STTR grant funding and contracts, and that's actually over $2 million now. And we've had a number of teams that have gone on to raise private capital. So we've had some good outcomes already. This program's only been around for a couple years in West Virginia. But again, I think it's really adding a lot of value to our ecosystem, which is why I wanted to talk about it today. We would love to get folks from all over the state participating in this. Obviously, we've had a number of folks participate from WVU. We've had some from Tech. We've had some from the community. But we would love to see more participation from some of the other universities in the state and just more broadly across our communities. In terms of the short course schedule, we actually have another course coming up that's going to start June 7th, I believe it is. So right at the beginning of June, again, that'll take us just to June 30th. But we typically run this three times a year. So we have a summer course, a fall course, and then a spring course is our typical schedule. The course registration right now is open for anybody who wants to apply. But again, this is on a first come, first serve basis. So if you have folks or you yourself want to go through the course, I would suggest getting in there sooner rather than later and going ahead and enrolling for this next cohort. I have some additional information and links on here just in case anybody's interested. The uni.org there, that gives you more information about the hub that I mentioned through the Upper New York hub that we're a part of. The first link there takes you to more general information about the NSF program. And then again, if anybody has questions, by all means, feel free to reach out to me. I'm more than happy to talk about this program more. Like I said, I saw Carrie and Ann on. Those are just two of our wonderful instructors that we have that help teach the course. And that being said, if you're interested in becoming an I-Corps instructor, also please reach out to me. There's a process that you can go through to become a certified instructor, and we're always looking for more folks who would want to contribute there. So with that, I will go ahead and stop. And if anybody has questions.
Yeah, Amber Ravencroft has dropped one into the chat. Marianne.
I was wondering, Bill, if do you have to have a startup, or can it be an entrepreneurial venture where employees of an existing firm go through the process?
That's a great question. Yeah. So you do not have to have a company. So we have people very, very early stage who really just have an idea, who kind of want to do a little bit of market testing with their idea. Or if you're a startup or a company and you want to maybe go through this process to think about a new product offering or something like that. So it's very flexible. Again, that's for the regional course. At the national course, there's a few more restrictions, but for at the regional course, it's fairly open to anybody.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Anybody else wants to drop a question in chat or just unmute yourself real quickly? We're pretty informal here.
Hi, Ariane.
Hi, Kevin.
Can you share your slides?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll make sure that Bill gets them if that's the easiest way, Bill. And then if you could email them out, if that's okay.
Yeah,
I have someone in your backyard who should consider this. He's coming closer and closer to starting a company. And I don't think he's reached out to you yet. But
great. Yeah, and my email address is at the end of those slides. So people are more than happy to have them reach out to me directly.
Good. Yeah, if you will just send me, I'll attach them with the notes. When the notes go out, I will put that with it.
Great.
All right. Anybody else? Thank you so much. That was super cool. I knew generally about the program, but that was great information. Thank you, Ariane.
Fantastic. Thanks, Bill. Appreciate it.
Hey, Ariane, can I just point at one quick thing? I can't keep I can't keep my mouth shut about this program because I think it's really terrific. But something that, you know, I think is really interesting is that you get a lot of people who have been working in their own silos, working, let's say, in health sciences or in engineering. And so this is a great way for them to sort of push their brain in a direction, but also to see how other people who are very different from them are attacking a problem. So it's a really great way for people to sort of think outside of their own sort of area.
Yeah, thanks, Ann.
Cool, that's great. Well, thank you all so much. We will include those slides with the notes when they go out tomorrow. And we're gonna move on, Lauren Kemp. Lauren, if you're, will unmute yourself. Lauren is going to present to us today on the 14th Street West initiative that's going on in Huntington and doing some great revitalization work.
Thanks, Bill. I'm gonna share my screen. So my name's Lauren Kemp, and I serve as the director of a new nonprofit organization called Renewal. And this organization was started in partnership between Audie Perry, Brandon Dennison, and myself to advance Main Street redevelopment initiatives in 14th Street West, which isn't downtown Huntington, but it is a part of Huntington. And so this neighborhood kind of commercial district has a lot of opportunity because there's a lot of commercial property that's for sale in the vicinity. It's very close to the I-64 interstate. It actually is the only part of Huntington that the numbered streets actually touches the interstate. And so there's a lot of opportunity to, you know, redevelop properties. And we needed a coordinating group. And so that's what Renewal does. We offer the coordination and are working with residents in the neighborhood and then also partners and institutions in the community to create, you know, some systematic change initiatives. We're using a Main Street America, model to promote this community transformation. So this involves, you know, taking into account what are the economic drivers of the district. Right now, the district's known for used merchandise and antiques, and also, you know, improving the design. And I know that downtown Huntington especially has really worked hard on beautification efforts, things like that, that make people feel more safe and, you know, continue to come back to the downtown area. Promotion, creating a unified, you know, message and brand that will bring people to the neighborhood, not only just as customers, but as potential business owners and investors. And then organization, back to that point of being a strong coordinator and really supporting that idea of buying local and supporting local business. The other part of what we're doing is we're actually creating a museum and other community arts and culture-based events to leverage the creative placemaking aspects of our opportunities in the West End. So this is a picture of 14th Street West. You can see it was very industrial on one side of the street and residential on the other side of the street. This is one of our favorite pictures because it's I think around the 1910 time, and you can see, you know, just that there was a lot happening here. And we didn't have paved streets, so it kind of shows how far we've come and how much the district has changed already in the past. We came together with Heritage Farm to get a grant to get a National Endowment of the Arts, Our Town grant. And this allowed us to create a plan document as our guiding principle. We are able to use this plan to show our new identity as 14th Street West, and also, you know, key initiatives that we think will advance the business development and cultural capital of our area. So you can see here, there's again, kind of mirroring the Main Street America themes of identity, with identity, place, and economy, with organization being kind of the thread that overlaps all of those things. Here's some of our key strategies, obviously creating unique destinations, vibrant outdoor spaces. We have a little park in the district that we recently received a land and water conservation grant to do a bunch of work to. Working on transportation, safety issues, connecting bicycle paths, bus routes, things like that to the district. And again, back to the events, the programs, the pop-ups, all the things, business development things that are our programs and organization. So really our main challenge was to make some of the business owners, especially the antiques vendors, feel like they were doing something creative and interesting, and help them kind of evolve in their business. Because one thing I, as a younger person, find cool about antiques and vintage thing is the sustainability. And I think that that's something that a lot of the antiques owners don't consider, is, you know, the sustainability of used merchandise. So that's something that we can kind of bring into the antiques district and add new businesses that will, you know, take advantage of that unique aspect. We've been able to do a lot of successful pop-up events. I used to work at Unlimited Future, so I know all about testing your ideas and doing, you know, lean startup. And that's been our approach in this district, is to use pop-up events and, you know, do things. We painted the street with tempura, like kids' finger paint, and we did this crosswalk. It represents something that mirrors the public art that we have in the area, which is quilt squares. And it was a way for us to all kind of get together and engage a lot of neighbors in the community. And it was fun. So again, we had some empty building over here on the left side. We just set up some easels and some arts, put up some string lights, and we had an art show in the building. So those are some examples. And we obviously do lots of stuff for the holidays and just try to have fun in what we're doing. And this, the next series of slides are just some things, because I think when you think of an antiques district, your ideas might be about furniture, but there's a lot of things that are unique to Huntington and West Virginia and aren't just, you know, your standard kind of, you know, buffets and dining room tables and things like that. We have a lot of interesting things, political buttons, you know, industrial things. There's a lot more that we could do with, like I said, marketing towards sustainability and marketing towards aesthetics. And that's something that we're trying to work on. And so, like I said in the beginning, the history of the area being industrial, it actually was its own town and then was annexed into Huntington. So we now have a small history exhibit that we hope to turn into like a full-fledged museum someday. We used to have a brewery on the street. We're hoping to get another brewery on the street that, you know, can kind of capitalize on all of the, you know, old ad prints and things that we have in the district. And we've worked a lot on public art. This is an example of the most recent mural. It's in a folk art style, and it has a lot of the colors and kind of themes that we're representing in our district plan. This is a rendering of, you know, kind of putting out our brand of revitalization. What does it mean to us to be revitalizing 14th Street West? And talking about, we focusing on our heritage, infusing creativity and what we have in our assets, and reinventing the district and really relying on that West Virginia spirit of resiliency. Recently, we were able to actually put up new pole banners, which is kind of a small thing, but it's a big thing because it's the first kind of visualization of that new brand. On the left is just a sketch of what it could look like, and on the right is what we actually installed last week, just a few days ago. And this is my contact information. I'd be happy to send out this link if folks want to take a look at our district plan. Contact me if you have any ideas. We have 19 small businesses in our district, and you know, I've been connected with a lot of technical assistance resources and things like that in my starting up. I started in August, so so coming up on a year pretty soon.
It's a great work that's going on in Huntington. I think also for the other partner organizations out here, there's some great opportunities for businesses and new and emerging industries down in West Huntington. Clearly, you all know that I was at RCBI for a long time. I did a lot of work with Lauren and with UFI and the Wild Ramp and different organizations, and was on the board at Renewall briefly before I had to make a little bit of a move there. So there's some great opportunities going on in West Huntington right now for people. So super exciting. Anybody have any questions? All right. Thank you, Lauren, for presenting today. Marjorie? I think Tina has stepped aside for a second, so I'm not going to be able to let you screen share. If you're on mute, and if you'll send me the PDF, I'll send it out to everybody.
I was able to share my screen until just now. That's too bad.
Yeah, you can. You should be co-host. Yeah, you're co-host.
Okay. Let me try again. Hey, thank you, Bill. And kudos to Lauren. That work sounds really, really interesting in what you're doing. If anyone knows Nashville, they might know 12 South. I'm going to start thinking about 14 Street West in the same way we think of Nashville's amazing corridor there with, you know, great businesses and activity. So congrats to you, Lauren. My name is Marjorie Cook. I am the marketing and communications director for Advantage Valley, an 8-county economic development marketing organization. And we are in the midst of an entrepreneurship program. We're probably in year and a half, about year and a half point of a 3-year program. And we continue our entrepreneurship virtual webinar series. This upcoming webinar this Thursday night is the 11th webinar in our series and the second in the food and beverage sector, one that has been identified in some of our research from 2018 as a very promising sector for entrepreneurship. Based on some numbers we crunched, I have data on that if you want to see it, but really exciting. Thursday night, we have basically a learn how to scale up your food or beverage manufacturing to allow your business to grow. It's specifically meant for folks who want to run through the FASTER program in our 8-county region, which is Boone, Braxton, Cabell, Clay, Kanawha, Lincoln, Putnam, and Wayne. However, this data and information could be helpful to folks statewide. If you know of a cottage food industry or someone who's making their biscuit recipe could go and be sold in stores. If someone has a beverage product that they need to go the next step, we are focusing this on how to do that, how to work in a commercial kitchen or to work with a co-packer. We have 3 co-packers who are going to be presenting. We have Sam Peters with Patterfam Sauces, John Yates at Vandalia Co-Packing, and Jim Adkins and Phil Bradley with the huge company Tasty Blend going to be presenting on this webinar, as well as we're bringing in a consumer packaged food industry expert. You see her down at the bottom. Her name is Sari Kimball. and she is out of Colorado, and she is really an expert in this niche, like the growth of businesses from you've got it started and now you want to take it to a larger market. We find her so engaging and her skill set so helpful. And Lacey Davidson with the Department of Agriculture shares that we actually do have a kind of a missing void a bit in our state. And she says that they often recommend folks for processing. It's a niche that we need some help with. So we, through Faster West Virginia, we are going to offer up her training and working with her in, you know, a cohort of students at reduced rate. Our program will pick up her costs to help people move through. So encourage anyone that you know that is kind of at this space, they have a food or beverage manufacturing that they kind of are at a growth phase and they need to go the next step. This is Thursday night, May 13th at 6 p.m. Hope you can help us share it. It's being pushed out on social, and I'll put the information in the chat about how to register. So I appreciate the opportunity here to talk a little bit about it. It should be great. We already have 50 folks registered, and we'd like to add as many to that as we can.
And Marjorie, that is, I know you all primarily target the Advantage Valley, but those people beyond the Advantage Valley can participate, correct?
Absolutely. Because there are SBDC coaches that cover statewide, we can help connect anyone to a business coach. I mean, that's part of the Faster West Virginia process, is to work with a business coach, take an entrepreneurship class, and then only the folks in our eight counties have access to the Faster West Virginia Loan Fund. So that's a little restrictive part, but we have two classes, a Kaufman Fast Track class started just last week, May 6th. We can get anyone into that in the eight counties. And we also have a Unlimited Future Planning for Profit course that starts June 8th. So, but yes, we can. This can be a statewide participation, and it's a small niche, but if you know someone in that arena, it can be really helpful.
Yeah, there are so many opportunities in food and beverage in West Virginia, and especially with some of our changing laws, the beverage manufacturing hopefully will continue to grow, and we'll see some growth in that. And I think for a lot of our Main Street communities, there are, and not just Main Street communities, but our downtown areas, there are some great opportunities to do small microbreweries, things like that, that really bring in new and differentiated economies into the area. I was just in White Sulphur Springs, and what they're doing downtown is phenomenal. So thank you for sharing that today, Marjorie. We will move on. Quick update. Most of you all were on last week, almost 2 weeks ago now, for the West Virginia Business Link kickoff with SourceLink. Thank you to everyone who attended. Just a quick reminder from me that if you have not yet filled out your resource partner form, I just dropped the link into the chat, and that's there. The only way you'll be able to get references from this website when it goes live is if you take the 5 to 10 minutes that it takes to go through and put your ID in as the West Virginia business at the West Virginia Business Link site. We have 23 organizations already in, and some more of you all will start to get individual emails from me to remind you if you haven't done that yet. But, you know, if you need to go back and review the video from the Zoom that day, I'll put that link in the chat as well. And then, of course, if anybody has any questions, you can reach out to me, and I'll put my new email, because that's changed. I'll put my new email into the chat so that everybody has that. Next up, that's just a quick little commercial there. And then next up, we have Ann Barth. Ann, if you want to unmute yourself and talk a little bit about your SBIR program.
Sure. You guys probably, many of you may know that Tech Connect has partnered with the SBDC with a FAST grant to raise awareness and education around the Small Business Innovation Research and Small Business Technology Transfer Program. And on June the 3rd, we will host our 8th boot camp about SBIRs and STTRs in the current year of the grant. Really aimed at people who have some technology that could be used by the government. They're doing some research that might be of interest to the government. 11 federal agencies participate. And the boot camps really just give an overview, but they also connect people with resources and people that they can be in touch with if they decide on a topic and identify the opportunity that they want to go after. We can help with that as well. But I share that with you in case you're working with entrepreneurs in that tech-centric space that might benefit from learning about what is rightfully called America's largest seed fund. And there are a lot of incentives now in the state to go after this type of funding, not the least of which is our matching fund. But we want to provide information to anyone working on this type of initiative and support them. So I'm happy to answer questions, and I'll put my email in the chat box for those of you who may not have it. And thank you, Bill, for letting me promote the June 3rd event.
Yep. Thank you, Anne. We appreciate all that Tech Connect does for the ecosystem. Did ask Steve Johnson to drop in today. The SBDC has a new effort going on that many of you may be aware of, but some of you may not, and you may have clients who could take advantage of this. It's called the Subject Matter Expert Program, brought to you by some CARES funding. So Steve, if you'd like to give us the quick thumbnail of what's going on with the SME program and how people can take advantage of it.
Sure, glad to. Thanks for having me on, guys. I appreciate it. Just wanted to do a quick update. As Bill said, the SBDC did get some CARES Act money, and we're doing several projects with that. But one of the ones that I want to talk about today is our subject matter expert program. We've seen the need to kind of offer some higher level consulting, things that we as the SBDC weren't completely prepared to do. But also, we needed to increase our reach. We have 16 coaches across the state, and that's a big territory to cover, as all you all know. So the CARES Act money allowed us to bring on subject matter experts from around the state. Most of them are running their own small businesses as consulting firms, and we are offering those people out to small businesses in West Virginia. I'm bringing this to you guys because we would like for you all to share this with people you're working with and that you know, and offer this. This is a free service, just like our coaching is. The way to access it is just simply become an SBDC client, and they're charged for that either, of course. And that gives them access to not only our coaching services that we have always offered and will continue to offer, but some specializations that we've never been able to offer before. I'm not going to give you the big long list. We've brought on 17 SMEs so far, with plans to maybe bring on a few more as we roll this out. We've been a couple of months getting bugs worked out, as you, you can imagine. That's always interesting. But we are rolling really good now, and probably going to bring a couple more SMEs on. I'll give Bill the one pager we have on this program that has just the generic descriptions of what we're offering. And then I'm happy to talk to you about it if you have somebody in mind. Any of our business coaches throughout the state that most of you, I'm sure, are aware of, will be happy to discuss it as well. But just for the sake of time, I'm just going to hit a few high points here. We have several SMEs in the marketing realm, everything from helping people actually set up to do e-commerce, website development, SEO for existing advertising for on Facebook, anything you can think of marketing-wise, we probably have somebody that has a specialty in that. But a really good crew on the marketing SMEs. Government contracting, as far as like SAM registration, contract bidding and performance, just in general business operations, such as access to capital, workforce, which we're all struggling with that, insurance, OSHA guidelines when you're bringing people back, redesigning your physical space for safety from COVID. Cybersecurity, we've got two really great firms for cybersecurity. A lot of us are now teleworking, and that opens up a whole nother plethora of issues for cybersecurity. So we have two companies that are doing that for us. General accounting, human resources. I think we have three human resources firms. Lots of issues with that right now. They're staying very busy. And business succession, which is something we've always wanted to try to get into and see a big need in West Virginia for. So we have two people who are experienced with that, doing exit strategies, valuing your business. This is not an official valuation full blown, but it is, you know, looking at your numbers and seeing what possibly you could get for selling it. I think I hit all the highlights there. Yeah. So I will give this to Bill. Please feel free to share it with your folks. If you have questions on, like I said, please get with me. We have lots of bandwidth to put people with these SMEs that we do want your help with. We want to make this program as successful as possible, but to us, success is to help as many businesses as possible. So the more you can send our way, we would appreciate it. We do have the bandwidth to put some more SMEs on if we get an inflow from you guys and the community at large. So thanks, Bill. Appreciate your time. I know you guys have other stuff on the agenda, so I'll be quiet now. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, Steve. Anybody have questions for Steve, specifically about SME or generally about SBDC stuff? I know that there is some really good work going on out there. I've talked to some people who are involved with the SME program, and they were really, really happy with the results they were getting, a very direct connection.
Quick question, is this open to nonprofit businesses to take part in the SMEs as well?
It depends. That's case by case.
Got it. Thanks. Excuse
me. Yeah, it just depends on what they're doing. Yeah, just as a general rule of thumb, if they're working with small businesses and providing services for small businesses, more than likely. I'd be glad to talk to you about it, Dwayne.
Thanks.
And there's really a great width and breadth there of specialties, and of course a lot of marketing, like Steve said, and cybersecurity. But beyond that, just a lot of opportunities to help improve our small businesses. So a really good program. Tyler, do you have any training updates for us? Tyler, are you on here? May not have made it. He told me he was on a client visit today. Just a reminder, like I always send out in the agenda, you can either send your things directly to Tyler Brandstetter, who will put them on the Google, or once you get access, you can add your own events to the Google training calendar. It's super important, just kind of one of the original thoughts of our getting together was that we were all working over top of each other, and we needed to make sure that at least as we could, we were trying to space those out. It's hard to get enough days in the month that everybody isn't training on something on the same day, but at least trying to pay attention, and maybe we're not doing both the same topic at the exact same time via Zoom or in person, sometimes in person in the same geography. So just a quick reminder to everybody about the Google Calendar, and when you got your notification, that link was in there. So it's always available once Tyler approves you to put information in. That is our run through this month. We're actually a little bit ahead of time. If anybody else has updates from the system, just you can unmute yourself and let us know. I don't hear anybody. If anybody's talking, you're still muted. So if nobody else has updates, we'll call this one at 45 minutes today. Good bit of information shared. Looking for our spotlight program for June. Just a quick reminder before we get off, you'll get your invitation, of course, but we'll be the second Tuesday is June 8th. So we get going early in the month of June with our second Tuesday. So I will see you all second Tuesday at 2 if nobody has anything else. All right. Thank you, everybody. Talk to you soon.
Thanks, Bill.
Thank you.